In this video, I'm going to explain how to use a linked list in Project Spark, and I'm going to say what it is and show how or why you might want to use one. So the example here I have is I've got a collection of food items here, and I want to display a shopping list of the food items. So the first thing I've done is I've created a shopping list object set, and I've incremented it by each of the items that are on it. And I want my list to be in a very specific order. I want eggs, and then meat, and then pumpkin, shish kebab, and then cabbage. So I've added them in that order. I also have this logic cube that's called head of list, and we're going to ignore that for the first two examples I'm using. So what I've done is in the brain of each food item, I've given it a number, and that's the number that I want the list to be in. So this is sort of my ideal ordering of the list. So the egg first, meat next, pumpkin third, and so on. So what I'm doing here is I'm saying for each of the shopping list, display its number position and its name and picture. So as we can see, the way that the object set is stored is not in the order that I've added them to. Object sets in Project Spark are called unordered lists. That means that you cannot determine the order that it keeps items in. There is an order, but it's not one that you can set. And so the way it happened to collect these items is it put the cabbage second, and it put the pumpkin after the shish kebab, and so that's just totally wrong for my purposes. But the numbers are there, 1 through 5. Now in this little setup I have, when I bump one of my food items, it's deleted from the world, and therefore the list. So I'm going to delete the meat. So here it maintained that same order it had. It took the meat out and moved everything else up. And the list is still in order. So it renumbered the list, 1, 2, 3, 4. So that's good. They're not the ideal number, but you know, if 2 is missing from a list, then you should rewrite the numbers anyway to make your list have the right numbers. So this is method 1 that I just showed. I said for each of the shopping list items, ignoring that head of list logic cube for now. First, we're going to store the current index of this loop, which is what this tile returns. Store it in a number variable that I'm calling current index. So we're going to display that number, and that's the number of our list, the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then this is just the period character plus a space, and that's just for formatting. So display the number, and then a dot and a space. And then the name of it, which is the object we're currently looking at on the shopping list. So as it goes through, it found the egg first, so that was good. So it displayed its name, and then down here, display it just displays the gallery image for that item. So display the egg's picture. And so that was right, but then the second thing that happened to be in the order it collected was the cabbage, and that was not correct. So we had the cabbage next as number 2 and the picture of the cabbage. So that way it doesn't really work for what we want. So here's what I did next. Again, I said for each of the shopping list items, ignoring that head of list logic cube for now, display, and then I used those numbers that I hard coded in each one of the items. So I told the egg you're in position 1 and the meat that you're in position 2. So I'm accessing those number variables and displaying those instead. And then I'm also displaying its name. And I'm doing the same thing, I'm just displaying the picture here. So it knows, each item knows where it's supposed to be in the list. So then the trick here is that I'm using the priority tile. So the priority, if we look at the description for it, it specifies the order of UI objects when snapped to a screen location. And the most important thing here is that the higher priority elements are stacked above the lower priority elements. So if we use the list position as the priority, then this will work if we just had the priority is its list position. That works, except that unfortunately the list is upside down. So the cabbage being list position 5 was at the top of the screen, and the egg was at the bottom of the screen. So we can fix that by just saying the count, which is 5 items when we have a full list, minus wherever it is on the list. So the cabbage is item 5, so we'll have 5 minus 5 is 0, and that's the lowest priority, so it puts it at the bottom. And the pumpkin was item 3, so we'll do 5 minus 3 is 2, so it puts it in the second spot, and so on. So this is a really good way to display them in order. But it does have one flaw, pretty significant flaw, I think. So that's this order here. It puts everything in the proper order, and that's just perfect. The only problem is when I delete the leg of meat, everything is maintained its proper order, but notice the numbering is totally wrong. It's using these hard-coded numbers I have, but number 2 is missing because I deleted it. And if you or I were to go shopping and someone gave us a list that had 3 items on it, numbered 1, 3, and 5, I don't think we would have any trouble figuring out what to buy after we buy eggs. We would know, okay, there's no number 2, we'll just skip to 3, and so on. And that's pretty easy for a person, but a computer program will have unpredictable results sometimes if there is no number 2. You know, it's looking for number 2 after number 1. And maybe it'll find 3, maybe it'll find 5, maybe it won't find anything. So we need to renumber the list as we've deleted items so that we have, when there are 3 items on the list, it says 1, 2, 3. Let me just go back. Remember this example, it renumbered. So we have 1, 2, 3 here, and that's great. It's just that they're in the wrong order. So either have the wrong order or the right order with the wrong numbers. So those are your 2 choices. But I've developed a 3rd choice, and that's list method 3. So that's this one. I'm using what's called a linked list. So we are going to use this logic cube called the head of list now. And the idea behind a linked list is that instead of telling each item what position it is on the list, so instead of saying egg, you're in position 1, meat, you're in position 2, what we do instead is we say, egg, wherever I put you, the guy that comes after you is the leg of meat. And meat, wherever you are, the guy that's after you is the pumpkin. And then so what I can do is I can loop through and I can display and this head of list is useful because, see, it points at the egg. Its object variable called next item points to the egg. So I can loop through and I can say, okay, tell me who's next. And this guy doesn't, it's a logic cube, so it doesn't have a name or a picture displayed. We skip it. See, it's list position equals 0 if we were going to use that. So I say, okay, who's next? And he says, well, the egg is next. And then we say, okay, egg, who's next? The meat is next. Okay, meat, who's next? The pumpkin is next. And so each object keeps track of who's next. So if I said, hey, meat, who came before you? He would say, I have no idea who was before me. I don't know where I am. All I know is the next place you need to go is to the pumpkin. And that's what this next item points at, is the pumpkin. So we can use, that's enough information to create a shopping list. If each list item knows what comes after it, we can say, okay, so the current item we're going to display on the list is equal to head of list, who's your next item? And he'll say, oh, it's the egg. So current item will point toward the egg when we begin. So then we go for each of the shopping list items. Again, we store the current index in a number variable. And this is how we renumber the list, so that's good. So we'll display number 1 plus whatever the current item is, whatever its name is. And so current item, remember, is currently pointing at the egg. So it'll display the egg name. And then it'll display its picture for the egg. And then we'll say, okay, current item, let's see. Current item, you need to be updated to whoever the current item is, their next item. So the current item, next item says, okay, egg, who is your next item? And he says, it's the leg of meat. And then the leg of meat gets reassigned to current item. And then the next time through, this will, remember, be number 2. And it'll say, display a 2 plus, and now this points to the leg of meat. And so that is a way of automatically renumbering and automatically following through the links of the list. That's why it's called a linked list. These next item links point to the next one. The deletion code is a little bit hard to follow, but that's what this is here. So when the player, that's my player object, bumps any of the members of the shopping list, I set a Boolean on it called marked for deletion and set that to true. I set it on that shopping list item. And then I loop through the shopping list. And if its next item is marked for deletion, then I store it as a delete me variable. And down here, I destroyed delete me. And then I update its next item to the next item's next item. So I know that's a little bit hard to understand, but especially if you're new to this. But basically what this is saying is, if let's say I bump the leg of meat. And so the first thing that happens is that the leg of meat gets this Boolean called marked for deletion set equal to true. So then as I loop through my shopping list, when I get to the egg, it'll say, its next item, which is the leg of meat, is it marked for deletion? Yes, it is. Okay, well, first thing we're going to do is we're going to store the leg of meat in this object variable called delete me. So the egg's next item is the leg of meat, so we'll keep track of that. The next thing we're going to do is the egg doesn't want to point toward the leg anymore because it's getting ready to get deleted. So its next item, the egg's next item, we'll update that to the its next item's next item. So these two tiles point to the leg of meat, and then this is the leg of meat's next item, which happens to be the pumpkin. So what we're saying here in this line, this is the how you delete something from the list line right here. We'll say the egg's next item is now pointing to the pumpkin. Hopefully that made sense. And then after we've kept track of that, now the leg of meat is no longer in the list, so we're going to destroy the leg of meat by referencing, remember, this delete me object variable that we just assigned up here. So I know especially the deletion code is a little bit difficult. Insertion, like if I added, say, clams to my list and I wanted them to be at between the egg and the meat, is even more complex. I'm going to cover insertion and sorting of linked lists probably in a couple of weeks. I'm going to make a more advanced linked list. But I wanted to introduce the idea. The good thing about linked lists, that's what this one is here, is that when you delete something, see, it's automatically renumbering them because it doesn't really care what position they're in. It just knows what the next one on the list is. So if I, again, if I had three items, even though their ideal numbering is 1, 3, 5, the linked list version is 1, 2, 3, which is what we want. So with this, you have the right numbers in the wrong order. With the other way, you had the right order with the wrong numbers. And using a linked list, you get both the right order and the right numbers. So that's sort of a preview of linked lists and how you can use them to keep track of things in Project Spark.